Hi, I'm Justin Weiss from IBM Research, and I'll be presenting this Introduction to Generative AI for Designers. And I'd like to start this talk off with a joke, and it goes like this. An AI engineer walks into a bar, and the bartender asks, "What can AI do?" The engineer responds with a bunch of these one-word answers, things like personalize and classify, and converse and generate. So next, we have an AI designer walk into the bar, and the bartender asks the same question, "What can AI do?" But the designer uses much different language when answering this question. He says things like detect liabilities and mitigate risk, recommend with confidence, and enrich interactions. So the bartender is confused. "Hey designer, aren't you forgetting something? Your engineer friend said that AI can also generate." So here's the punchline. Why aren't designers talking about generative AI? And if you've gone through the AI Essentials course, you'll see what I mean. The way we're teaching our designers about AI is by focusing on these six core intents. But these leave out a powerful class of AI capability focused on generating content. And my goal in this lightning talk is to add the word generate to your AI vocabulary. So for the rest of this talk, I'll give a brief overview of generative AI, including three of the most common types of generative models and a lot of examples of what they can do. We'll also touch briefly on some of the utopias and dystopias that generative AI technologies can create. So I'd like to start with a definition of generative AI, and this is the class of AI models that are capable of producing artifacts or pieces of artifacts as outputs. And when I say artifacts, I mean things like text or images or videos or even audio. And as I mentioned, there's three popular kinds of generative models: transformer models, generative adversarial networks, and autoencoder models. So let's start with transformer models. The easiest way to think about these models is that things go in, they're transformed, and then things come out. And visually, it looks like this. Here we have a sequence of English words going into the model. They get transformed into another language like Klingon. Then they come out as a sequence of Klingon words. But even though this model looks very simple, they're actually quite powerful. And some of the magic of this model is that they can keep producing output even when you've run out of things to input into them. Here's one example of a transformer model called GPT-3, which you may have heard of. This is a really cool model because it's been shown to be capable of many different kinds of things, such as writing stories and news articles and even podcasts. In this example, we see a poem written by GPT-3, and while I'm not the best judge of whether this is a good poem or a bad poem, I'll bet that if I didn't tell you that this was written by an AI system, you probably would have thought that a person wrote it. But writing poems and stories is not the only thing that this model can do. Here's an example where GPT-3 is being used to create a UI design. And here we see a designer writing in natural language about the UI they want to design, and the model transforms this into the actual UI layout in Figma. One more use case for transformer models is around source code. This is another model called Transcoder, which is able to translate source code from Java to Python. And this is an interesting use case because with source code, we care a lot about its quality. We don't want code with bugs in it. But in a recent study from my team, we showed that even when this model produces flawed code translations, software engineers are still happy to work with them because it speeds up their work. So this is one thing to consider as a designer. The generative model doesn't necessarily need to produce 100% perfect output as long as you design your system to let users easily modify the generated content. Okay, so moving on to our next kind of generative model, let's talk about GANs. And the easiest way to remember how GANs work is like this: one creates and one discriminates. Here's what it looks like. There's actually two models here, the generator and the discriminator. The job of the generator is to create things that fool the discriminator, and the job of the discriminator is to not be fooled. So in this example, we see the generator created an image of a hot dog, and the discriminator figured out that it's really not a hot dog. And because these two models are working against each other in this way, it forces the generator to be able to create really high fidelity content. So here's an example of what I'm talking about. These images were created with a model called StyleGAN. They're actually really detailed images of people's faces. But these aren't actually real people. And again, as with the poem example, if I didn't tell you that, you probably would have thought that these were just photographs. So you might be thinking, well, how is this useful? Well, here's one example. This is a tool called UI Faces, which has plugins for Sketch and Figma and Adobe XD. Do you ever find yourself creating mock-up UIs and need to insert stock photography of people's faces? Well, now you have a way to generate exactly the kind of face you're looking for. Okay, let's talk about autoencoders now. The whole premise of autoencoder models is that things are just lists of numbers. So this is what it looks like. On the left, we have a long yellow rectangle, which is a thing represented by a long list of numbers. And the first piece of the autoencoder model is the encoder, which reduces our long list of numbers to a much smaller list. This smaller list is known as the latent representation of the thing. And this is where the magic happens. When we manipulate this representation by changing around the numbers, it causes it to change in meaningful ways after it's gone back through the decoding process. Let me show you an example of what I mean. This is a tool created in IBM Research called the COVID-19 Molecule Explorer. Here, molecules are the things that we've represented with lots of numbers. And this model has been trained on a lot of molecules with properties we know about, such as if they act as drugs or whether they're toxic. So when we take these drug-like molecules and manipulate their latent representations, we're able to create new kinds of molecules that have similar properties. So let me wrap up this section by pointing out this site called Algorithm-Driven Design. And there are so many more examples about how all kinds of AI models, including generative ones, are being used in the design space. So I highly recommend you check this out. This brings me to the last part of this talk, where I'll briefly discuss some of the utopias and dystopias that can be created because of generative AI. So these are the utopias, which are really some of the main benefits provided by generative models, things like scale and speed and inspiration. And I've hinted at these earlier, but here's a few more examples. For scale, Nutella had a marketing campaign where they created 7 million unique product labels using generative methods. And for speed, this is a really great example from Airbnb. They built a system that let their designers draw UI sketches on paper, and the system would translate them into actual implemented UI in real time. The system shows how generative models can really speed up your work. This last example is about inspiration, and it comes from a band called Yacht. They used a generative language model to help them write song lyrics for their album. The model would create a bunch of inspirational lyrics, which the band then selected and remixed into the actual lyrics for their songs. So these are really nice examples of the benefits of generative AI, but there's also one major downside, which is deepfakes. And you've probably seen this, where deep generative models are being used to do things like put your face on top of someone else's body or transform your voice to sound like someone else. And while these might be fun and playful things to do, this technology can also be abused. These are a few headlines about people abusing generative technologies, things like tricking a CFO into making a fraudulent payment, or using a deepfake to have someone do a job interview for you. And taken to an extreme, we can imagine how generative technologies can lead us towards some very dystopian outcomes, such as insurance companies manufacturing evidence to deny claims, or governments manufacturing evidence to lock up innocent people. And if you're interested in learning more, I encourage you to read our paper. So to wrap up this talk, I'd like to leave you with these three takeaways. First, I hope you've learned enough to be able to add generate to your AI vocabulary. And second, I hope I've inspired you to learn more about these technologies and think about how they can be applied both within IBM and with our customers. And finally, I charge you with thinking about how design can be used to create enterprise-grade generative AI systems that avoid the potentials for abuse I just discussed. So that's my talk, and thank you so much for listening.